Hi folks, I'm Frank McSherry and I'm going to talk you through timely data flow. I'm going to try to make it as easy as I know how. So let's start with data flow programs, which are different from what you might be used to, which is imperative programming. Data flow programs take a different approach where instead of describing a sequence of actions the computer must take, they describe a collection of imperative operators, these named boxes connected by data flow edges along which data move. As data move through the computation along the edges, the operators take actions. They might restrict the data or transform it or potentially accumulate it and produce new outputs. Interestingly, the data is what drives the computation. So as the data move, computation happens, in contrast with imperative computation, where your program specifies exactly what needs to happen next. This exchanges control from an imperative program, control over how the computer is executed, to trading that away to provide improved, potentially, efficiency and scaling. So if the underlying system can think of a better way to process your computation, for example, up above it might take hello and world and filter them both at the same time. It might take your three operators, filter, map, and count, and put them on different computers to improve the throughput of the computation. At the same time, writing your program as data flow also reveals, both to the system and to other users, how your computation should respond to new data. So if new information arrives in the input, the data flow program makes it very clear what do we do with this data to maintain your computation. This is in contrast with imperative programs, where if the input data change, there's usually not much to do except rerun your computation from scratch, which is too bad. Now, in our world, all of these records are going to have timestamps. These things, time one and time two. These could mean several different things. The time might be when the record was admitted into the system. It might be a more semantically meaningful time that the person who created the data attached to it. The main point is going to be as records flow through the system, they will maintain their timestamps moving forward. Why do we do this? Why do we put timestamps on records? It gives us a way for operators like count to be sure they've produced correct outputs. So count wants to produce for each string the number of times it saw it in its input. And here it sees world at least once at time two. But before it can produce a correct answer, it needs to be quite certain that there's not a second copy of that same string coming at the same time. So count is very interested in learning that there will be no more records with time two, at which point it can produce a correct output. So these timestamps are the language in which the system speaks to the operators and tells them about, in this case, the least time that they may yet see on any of their input data. And that allows operators like count to await that signal and then perform their computation and produce correct output, when otherwise they would never be quite sure if it was safe to produce any particular output. Now, this is all fairly standard data flow programming. Let's talk about timely data flow. So timely data flow, well, it derives from this paper, NIAID, A Timely Data Flow System, which is a pretty cool paper. I recommend it. I think there are three exciting things that distinguish timely data flow from other more standard data flow systems. I'm going to talk through those. The most obvious and prominent one is that timely data flow allows much more expressive data flow computations. In particular, it allows data flows that contain structured cycles, potentially nested cycles too. This allows you to write iterative computations, much in the same way that a while loop in your imperative program allows you to write iteration. This is possible because of a subtle change that timely data flow makes to the operator API. We'll see there that there's a very slight change that allows iteration to take place. That's really cool. It reduces the amount of coordination between workers to the point that loops become feasible. And this is possible only because timely data flow takes a slightly different approach to how it shares responsibility for executing the data flow across its workers. This is a way that happens to, even for just a single worker, scale up to thousands of data flows and millions of operators in those data flows. So we're going to talk about these in the opposite order, building up a foundation and arriving at the sort of key feature of loops. So let's talk about how data flow systems share responsibility between workers. This is one of the key features of a data flow system, is that they can take a computation and divide it up amongst multiple different workers who can operate independently or bring independent resources to bear. Now generally these operators are going to have different requirements about what they need. Maybe filter and map both require relatively more CPU than they need memory. And count, which needs to remember what it's seen, may require relatively more memory than CPU. That might cause us to actually lay these out slightly differently. Maybe we have one worker handle filter and map. Maybe we have a whole bunch of workers handle count. It turns out with these requirements of CPU and memory, this is exactly the wrong thing to do. So there's a bunch of choices that the system has to make, and it can make them badly. That's a bit awkward. But the important theme here, actually, though, is that each worker gets a relatively myopic view of the data flow. So they can see some very narrow boundaries about the computation. They don't have a long view of the data flow, where inputs and outputs eventually go. So timely data flow, by contrast, is going to take a different approach here. It's going to slice the data flow up so that all workers have a view of the entire data flow graph. And each worker is responsible for a proportional fraction of each of the operators in the data flow graph. So in this case, the input operator will distribute its data roughly, let's say, 1/4 to each of the workers, who are then able locally to filter that data, apply the map to that data, just all on their own. Some operators, like count, are going to require these workers to communicate. So if we want to get the correct count for any given string, all copies of that string probably should go to the same worker so that it can get a correct total before producing the output. So workers absolutely will need to communicate. We can't avoid that. But this particular approach of slicing the data flow graph up has a few appealing properties. One, it gives out even shares of the CPU, RAM, and network. So our workers that might all have the same resources can give all of their CPU to filter and map, and all of their memory to count. And we don't have to pick specialized machines to handle these operators otherwise. The other appealing property is that each worker has a large view of the data flow graph, and we're going to see in just a moment that this is really helpful for improving the way in which these workers coordinate. So let's talk about that now. The operator API is how operators like count, filter, and map even interact with the system. Remember that the system is tasked with telling operators like count what is the least time at which they may yet see input data. And for the system to learn that, it needs to learn from filter and map. Well, what do they plan on producing in their output? So a fairly standard way to do this in traditional data flow processors is to have operators announce that they are done with certain times. The input operator might say, I'm done with time 2. I've sent my data at time 2. I don't plan on sending any more at time 2. This is information that will need to get shuffled around between workers. And once it is announced, each of these operators can, in sequence, or go through and reach the same conclusion. So the filter operator will process its data and make the same statement. Map will make the same statement. Count can finally take its action, produce some data, and then say, I'm done also with time 2. This is very sensible. This is exactly the information that we need to provide to count. So it makes a lot of sense that the operators would make this type of announcement. Now, timely data flow is going to do something a little bit different. Rather than reporting on the absence of data, it's going to report on the presence of data, which sounds a bit odd, but let me explain. So imagine instead the input operator said, I may have data at time 2. This is sort of analogous to saying I'm not yet done at time 2. But it makes a positive statement about data being present at time 2. And the worker who has that information now can look down its data flow operators and say, ah, great, I now know what to tell filter, map, count, and output about the times they may yet see. Apparently it's still time 2. Similarly, there are points in the data flow graph where data exists. Here we have world at time 2. It's only correct to inform people downstream there might be data at time 2. Though at the moment this is strictly redundant with the statement that the input operator made. But we'll see that it's really important. It's important because the input operator might at some point say, you know, I'm done with time 2. I've sent my data. Maybe filter dropped it all. Who knows? But now I might have data at time 3. And this is a fairly simple statement for the input operator to make. But what's interesting is that we don't have to do any work for filter or map. Those operators don't need to communicate with each other and inform anyone about changes in the possible times in their outputs. Each operator can just look at this changed information about the input, propagate locally, without chatting with other workers, locally, all the way down its data flow. It's not very interesting because at the moment, that information stops just before the count. But if that record were processed just before the count, this statement would fall away, the account would be ready to take some action and could go ahead and do so. The absence of that statement essentially unblocks the count and output, and again, the worker can locally learn all that information and tell all of its workers without repeated coordination with other workers. Similarly, if maybe time 3 passes and no data gets produced, the input operator moves to time 4. This is not a very uncommon thing to happen, and what's neat is that this information can now make its way all the way down this data flow graph with only one round of coordination between workers. They need to agree that the input operator is done with time 3. But we don't need to walk through filter, map, count, all the way down to output, bouncing between workers to learn that. So this is much more efficient for large data flow graphs, those with, let's say, thousands or millions of operators. But the very special case of data flow that we're going to see in just a moment where it's absolutely crucial. So traditional data flow operators are directed acyclic graphs. Sorry, data flow systems allow you to write directed acyclic graphs. Timely data flow is totally comfortable, allowing you to put cycles into your graph. So we put some logic here wrapped around map, and the map that lowercase has the string isn't super exciting, so maybe think instead of a map that removes the last character from a string, and repeating that process will generate all prefixes of strings. It's not the best way to do it, but you don't want a super complicated example. So why is this new to timely data flow? Why wouldn't existing data flow systems do something like this? And let's see what goes wrong when we try to use the standard approach to determining whether times have progressed in a data flow system. So imagine that logic has said, well, we're iterating a little bit. I propose that I'm done sending data with some iteration 1. Great, that's a good way to start. The count operator, you might notice, is ready to process something at time 2. We're doing this little iterative thing where we're counting up iterations. The map operator might take data in from logic, might produce some more output data for logic, and logic might then say, well, I'm now done with iteration 2. We should move along. The map operator may act on that, take its data, and it may produce no output data. That's possible, right? Maybe we ran out of string. So it tells logic that we should move along. The logic operator says, we're done with iteration 3. That's great. The map operator again does nothing. The logic says, well, we're done with iteration 4. And this process will continue indefinitely. There's no large step that these operators are able to take where they say, we must be done with the loop completely. It's very difficult because of their myopic view of the data flow for them to realize that there's a larger step that they should take. So they get stuck. Essentially, that count operator never gets to process its string coming in. World, one will never be produced as output. So let's look instead at how timely data flow handles this with its different approach to communicating about the presence of data rather than the absence. In this setting, we can imagine the input might say, I might have something at time 3, just to clarify that otherwise time 2 is done. And the logic might say, I may have some data at iteration 1, which it supplies to map. Map processes it, hands some data back to logic, which then says, I've got data at iteration 2. All this time, the count operator is being told by the worker, you're not good to go yet, we still have some stuff that's iterating at time 2, don't do anything. But as soon as logic hands the new data off to map and map drops it on the floor, there's no data anymore. And the two operators stop talking about the data that they might have. And the worker is able to look at the whole view of the data flow graph and say, you know what, I think we're done with time 2. And it'll tell the count operator that. The count operator can then produce world, one, and the iterative computation essentially completes, which is great, and it's something that the previous systems were getting stuck on. So this is essentially a sequence of 3 things that allow iterative computation to unfold in data flow programs. And we'll wrap with that. Timely data flow allows much more expressive computations to the extent that you believe iterative computation is an exciting thing to have in your data flow. There's a slight change to the operator API that reduces coordination. This is good for a bunch of reasons, but crucially to enable cycles. And a different architecture to how timely data flow organizes responsibility across the workers is what makes all of this possible. It decouples the resources you have, the number of workers, their CPU and memory, from the complexity of the data flow graph and allows millions of operators to run across relatively limited resources. There's a URL at the bottom if you'd like to learn any more. You can go and grab the code, play with examples, read some more documentation, or file some issues if you think things are not at all clear. Thank you very much.